In the late 70s, video game consoles and home computers weren't the only new craze starting to sweep the UK. Something else new was taking the country by storm, and this was partly due to the release of the movies Smokey and the Bandit in 1977 and Convoy a year later in 1978. Now, if you're worried about bears on your back door or getting hassle from a jam sandwich or simply wanted a 1013 from your home 20, then what better gadget to have in your car than something to speak to other road users with, whether you understood the lingo or not? Today in the shed, we're looking at something a little bit different. We're looking at good old CB radio. Now, what's interesting about CB radio and its bigger brother amateur radio is that there's a lot of community crossover from people interested in computing and video games who were also interested in radio back in the day. I suppose it's just another one of those geeky hobbies that some of us got into back in the day before there were mobile phones and the internet. Now, the main difference between CB radio and amateur radio can be summed up by saying that CB was used by people interested in using radio to talk to other people. Amateur radio, or hams as they are known by, not only like using the radio, they're much more interested in how radio actually works. A CB radio, or a citizens band radio, is essentially a short-range radio transceiver, which means that it can not only receive radio signals, but it can transmit them as well. It was designed to be used by private individuals to communicate with each other over short distances. They could be used in vehicles, or in homes, or offices. Radios came in the form of mobile sets designed to fit into vehicles and run off either 12 or 24 volts DC, and these were probably the most popular types that people used. There were larger home-based models that were designed, well, for homes and offices really, but these were more often than not the same model of mobile radio, but in a larger case, with its own mains power supply and an external speaker. You also had a choice of handheld portable units, which were a bit like walkie-talkies. Now, the concept of CB actually originated in the US back in the 1940s. But it wasn't until the FCC licensed CB for hobbyist use in 1975 until it really started to kick off. The US channels sit in a frequency range between 26.9 MHz and 27.4 MHz AM. Now, AM is the modulation type, and I'm not going to go into the technicalities of that here, but it's a method of radio transmission that uses the amplitude of the wave to transmit your signal. The legal power limit of CB radio was 4 watts, and it has a range of a few miles most of the time, and it depends on a number of factors. Now, if somebody's on the same channel as yourself and within range, the idea is you can hear and speak to each other. As long as you weren't on one of the specially designated channels such as 14 or 19, typically used by truckers and other mobile users, or channel 9, which was meant to be kept clear for emergencies, the idea was you pick a channel, they're free to use, and you could talk, or modulate as we used to call it, to anyone you liked. CB started to be widely used by US truck drivers after the 1973 fuel crisis, when 55 mile an hour speed limits and strict fuel rationing was introduced. The CB was often used to tell other drivers the location of speed traps, where to find supplies of fuel, and of course to arrange blockades and other illegal shenanigans. Now, a lot of these activities, like I said, were illegal, so people started to use handles to hide their true identity from the law. After all, to license a CB in the US, you had to provide a call sign, and if you're up to no good, the last thing you wanted was for the Smokey Bears, that's the police to the rest of us, to be able to figure out who you were and where to come knocking to find you. After all, in the US, the police used the CB as well to listen in and get the jump on what was going on, so handles were key, and also the use of coded phrases and the famous CB10 code came into use to hide the true purpose of the conversation. Anyone not particularly well versed with the CB10 code would have no idea why somebody would be telling you in what 1020 a potential 1073 had been spotted and 1010 their good buddy. In other words, they were telling you in what location there was a police speed trap and to take it easy and have a good day. After Smokey and the Bandit and the Convoy movies were released, CB fever hit new highs both in the US and here, and suddenly everybody wanted to get their hands on one. And that's when things started to get a bit messy here in the UK. If you were caught using a US AM radio, this would land you in hot water with the police. Plus, you were likely to have your very expensive imported radio confiscated. Not good. But what exactly was the problem with CB radio here in the UK? Well, the UK government had not allocated any part of the radio spectrum for common people to use. Using a radio to transmit willy-nilly? Dear Lord, we can't have that sort of thing going on. This is Britain and we need to govern the airwaves. Or something like that anyway. But going on it was, and people were buying very expensive imported US CB radios that worked on 27 MHz AM. A frequency that was already being used by other odds and sods here in the UK, such as remote control aircraft. Now, the US sets transmit on AM, and AM causes more than its fair share of interference to all sorts of other devices. From bedside alarm clocks, there's a story, televisions, radios, telephones, kettles, I kid you not, you name it, if you were on AM pushing a bit of power, you were going to screw up your neighbour's equipment. The craze here exploded, and suddenly there were Ford Cortinas, Escorts, Vauxhall Vivas, and tons of other motors ripping around, unless you were in Allegro, of course, Allegros didn't rip around, all looking like dodgem cars with massive big antennas, or whips as we call them, sticking out of them. Such was the craze that it was actually debated in the House of Commons, and something needed to be done. Therefore, in 1981, Citizens Band Radio was begrudgingly granted a part of the radio spectrum, consisted of 40 channels that sat between 27.6 and 27.9 MHz, maximum power outage was 4 watts, and all legal UK CB radios were branded with the CB2781 mark as a result. Legal all of a sudden, but there was still a problem. The UK sets had to use FM mode transmission and not AM like the US radios. AM and FM transmission, two very different methods of sending out radio waves. What this meant was people with illegal UK CBs could not talk to the illegal AM users, and people were not happy. Although FM has better audio quality than AM, it doesn't perform as well over distances because it's more affected by physical obstacles such as buildings. Despite this, FM radio took off, and CB radios were one of the hottest items to buy during Christmas of 1981, ranging from very basic sets that just had volume squelch and a channel selector, right up to very expensive flashy sets with a whole host of features and knobs such as mic gain, RF gain, delta tune, noise blanking and channel 9 selection. The sky was the limit. From £50 to £250, the choice was yours. Now, probably the single most important thing that determines how well or badly your CB was going to perform was, of course, the antenna. Now, the antenna takes your radio signal, mixed with your dulcet tones, of course, and radiates it out into the air so other stations can receive it. And if it's not efficient at doing this, not only can people not hear you, but you also can't hear them. Plus, you risk blowing up the guts of your radio. Now, as with many things in life, the bigger your antenna, the better it will perform. See, 27 MHz needs a long antenna because its wavelength is 11 meters. Now, if you wanted to stay at home and become a home base user, that was fine. There was plenty of antennas to choose from that you could mount directly to the roof or onto your wall or onto scaffolding poles or whatever. These came in many varieties, from the simple and legendary silver rod antenna to the amazing Avanti Sigma 4, right up to massive horizontal beams that looked like that you were running the Arecibo array from your semi-detached house in King's Norton. Of course, home-based antennas are much bigger than mobile ones and usually perform a lot better. Now, when you bought your shiny new antenna and put it together, it would need to be tuned before you used it. This was a trial and error process of shortening and lengthening the whip until the SWA meter showed you the smallest amount of reflected signal. I knew nothing about tuning antennas when I was bought my first ever CB and just slung the whole lot together and started to use it. 1 week later, my radio went pop, needed to go off for repair, and I learnt the hard way. A badly tuned antenna actually reflects the power your radio is pushing down the wire back into your radio, and this will eventually destroy the outputs. The more tuned your antenna is, the less of this power is reflected back to your radio, and it has an easier life. So once you have your radio and tuned antenna, what then? Well, pretty much, you talk to people. It was crazy on the CB back in the 70s and 80s. Of the 40 channels, sometimes it was difficult to find one that was free with no one talking on. There were hundreds of people on the radio in my neighbourhood, most of them personal friends, and we all had them. In fact, most of us had more than one. We had them in the car, we had them in our bedrooms at home, and some of us had portable units like the Midland Porterpack. Wherever we went, we had CB radio. It was a bit like a mobile phone is today. It was like social media before there was social media. You know how popular Facebook is now? Well, it was like that, but a lot more fun. And of course, it wasn't policed, so you really could say what you liked. You got chatted up, you did some chatting up, you met up, we used to call them eyeballs, and sometimes you drove away if you didn't like the look of them. Other times you pulled over and you met some wonderful people. It really did attract all sorts of people. And of course, there were the idiots. Oh yes. In any hobby, there are idiots, and the CB attracted more than its fair share. Most of them with silly echo or distortion microphones, pushing as much power as they can, just to piss people off, really. And believe it or not, some of those people are still around today. For me, CB started to die around 1993. A lot of people gave up on it, and of course mobile phones started to gain popularity in the 90s, and that didn't help poor old CB. Most of the time, CB where I am is now 40 channels of dead static, but there are a handful of people on. Now, I started to become interested in it again around about November 2019, and once COVID lockdown hit in April 2020, it came into its own again. And last summer was actually very, very busy on the radio. I spoke to people all over Europe finding out what was going on. Many old users came back on last summer during lockdown to see if they could simply talk to people again. The regulations have changed now. There is no more license requirements for a basic CB radio anymore. Most modern radios can easily be modified to cover much broader frequency ranges, and many can cover everything from 26 to 30 megahertz. So this is a typical very early 80s radio. It's an absolutely gorgeous radio, and I've had a few of these in my lifetime. This is made by Uniden. This is the classic UniAce 200, which would have been on sale in the very early 80s when it became legal in the UK. I mean, it's just that classic. I mean, look at it. It's all silvery and it's got lots of knobs and buttons on it. I dread to think how much this would have cost back in the 80s, but I reckon it would have been quite a bit. It's beautifully made. I mean, the channel selector on that is just, oh, it's just lovely. It's really, really well made. Let's have a quick look at it. On the front there, you can see the UK 2781 badge. That tells you it's legal. It's good for use in the UK. And this radio has your volume control, which is your volume on off. You have a squelch, and the squelch, what the squelch does, if I can you hear that annoying static sound? If you turn the squelch up, the squelch literally deadens that sound. He says, there you go. So the squelch deadens that sound until somebody transmits and it breaks the silence and you can hear what's going on. You've got a mic gain dial there, which increases and decreases the sound of your voice. And of course you have the RF gain, and what that does, that reduces and increases the signal strength of incoming signals. So if you're sat really close to somebody a few miles away pushing lots of power, you can turn the RF gain down a bit and stop them from blowing your windows out. So here we have, there's your channel selector. So if you turn the channel dial, there you go, channels are changing there. PA button, yeah, PA was a public address. You could put a speaker somewhere on your car, hit that and shout abuse to people going down the road. Not a good idea. Never legalised in the UK. So you had a tone high and low switch, which changes the pitch of the sound coming out the speaker. Power, the full 4 watts, or you can drop it down to 0.4 watts if you were talking to somebody just up the road. And the bright and dim on the display. So if it was after dark, you can hit that button and reduce your display brightness. I'm not going to transmit this radio because I haven't got an antenna on the back of it. That would be most unwise. So the signal strength meter shows you how powerful the station you're talking to is. The needle will start to move up the scale depending on how powerful the signal you're receiving is. So if you're speaking to somebody pushing a lot of power quite close to you, you'd hit them on a 30 plus, which if you look at the end of the scale there, you'll see that 30 plus dB and the needle bounces all the way to the end. And when you're transmitting, the needle shows you what your output power is looking like. Okay, quick look round the back. This is a UniAce 200, imported to London, made in Hong Kong. Unfortunately, it doesn't tell me what year it was made. There's your antenna socket. That's an SO239 antenna socket. That's where your antenna will plug in. DC 12 volts goes in there, and you've got two sockets, one for your PA and one for your external speaker. So if you had this thing sunk into your dashboard, you wouldn't be able to hear it very well because the speaker sits underneath. So the external speaker allows you to plug in an external speaker, believe it or not, so you can hear things a little clearer. Here's another little straightforward 40 channel FM UK radio, and look at the size difference there. That was very early 80s. This one was mid to late 80s, I believe. It's almost identical actually to the one my dad bought. My dad bought me a Moonraker Minor, same radio as this virtually, very basic. Now look at the difference here. You've got volume, you've got squelch, you've got your channel selector, you've got 4 watts, 0.4 watts from PA. that is it. You've got no RF gain, you've got no mic gain, you've got no tone control. It's a very, very small radio indeed. Much, much smaller, but I love it. I mean, it's just gorgeous. Look at that. This one's mint. I got it off eBay about 6 months ago for about 20 quid, next to nothing, and it works perfectly. Notice as well that in the mid to late 80s, people started doing away with the meter and just putting these four little LEDs in there. You can just see them. Again, I'm not going to key up, there's no antenna in it. But there's four little LEDs there just above the channel selector. There they are. And that was your signal meter, that was it. So if somebody was hitting you on a 30 plus, all four would light up. So not very accurate, but you know what? It did the trick. And I used one of these for about a year. It was this little radio that I blew up by not tuning my antenna in, but yeah, what a lovely little standard radio that is. If you know your CBs, you are going to recognise this beautiful thing a mile away. This is the President Lincoln Mark I. And again, it's a legendary bit of kit. This is not really a CB at all. This is amateur radio, as it says on the box. I first saw one of these, I think it must have been 87, 88. Chap by us had one in Kings Norton, but it wasn't the President Lincoln, it was the Uniden 2830. Literally the same radio, the first version of this radio. And I wanted it so badly, but yeah, not cheap. I think when it was released, you're looking well over £300 for a radio like this. This is, like I say, it's an amateur radio. It covers, this particular one covers, if I can turn the dial, there you go. So it goes from 26 megahertz to 30 megahertz. So that's a much, turn the volume down a sec. That's a much broader, this radio covers a much broader frequency range than the old Stray. So that's got 40 channels. This, you don't really think of using this as channels. You use frequencies on this thing. So what you do, you rotate that dial, if I can get the camera in there. And as you rotate the dial, you'll see the frequencies change. So although you do have a channel up and down on it, you don't use it. You use that. The features on this thing, wow. This covers, as you can see, FM, AM, upper sideband, lower sideband, and carrier wave. There's your SWR calibration. There's your delta tune. You've got RF power. So with the RF power, you can change how much power you're pushing. You can turn it down, turn it up. Volume squelch. You've got noise blanker, PA functions, mic gain, local DX, all sorts of really cool stuff on this radio. Like I said, this is not really a CB, although it was used as a CB. Originally, out of the box, this covers 28 to 30 megahertz, but this has been modded. Nearly all of them have been to cover 26 to 30, so you can easily cover the CB frequencies and a lot more. You can see it's quite a big chunky radio. If you look around the back, there's a big heatsink on the back there because it's got quite a powerful output transistors compared to the 4 watts that thing kicks. This one is in beautiful condition. I don't use it very often, as you can see. And it is a stunning bit of kit. Wanted one most of my life. Got one now. There's the mic for it. The mic has got channel select actually on the mic as well, so you can flip the mic up and down while you're driving and not worry about reaching down and pressing all those buttons. Beautiful radio, really is. This is what I'm currently using in the car. It's not in here at the moment, I can't show you. Here's the box for it. This is the President Lincoln 2 Plus. Nice looking machine, actually, but it is quite a bit smaller than the original Lincoln. And to be honest with you, I'm not as keen on this version of the radio as that one. I find the buttons on this very, very fiddly, very small. You can't tell from the size of the box how big it is, but it is a lot smaller than the original. It's just not as good. It just doesn't have the same feel as the original Lincoln. It's okay for use in the car. Again, it's got all the modes on it. It's got upper sideband, lower sideband, it's got FM, it's got AM. It's modded, it covers 26 to 30 megahertz, and it's not bad. It's just not as good as that. So those of you that were on CB back in the day will instantly recognise this antenna. This is the legendary K40. This was made in the US back in the day, in the 80s, and it outperformed almost everything else. It was absolutely incredible. Not cheap, but yeah, instantly recognisable. Very, very popular back in the day. It's got a stainless steel whip of about 4.5 feet long. Goes all the way over here. This one's tuned, and you tune it by turning that grub screw there, shortening or lengthening the antenna length until the standing wave ratio is as low as possible. This has got a lip mount on it, and the idea was you hook that over your boot or any other lip of the vehicle. I've got a mag mount for it somewhere actually. And you fed the coax to the back of the radio. So the load of the antenna is within that chamber there. So inside that black cylinder is a coil of wire that makes up the rest of that length. So when it's all fully unwound, it's probably three times the length. And what the coil does, it shortens the antenna physically, but electrically it's the right length to be compatible with 27 megahertz. Brilliant antenna. Unfortunately, this one's not in use at the moment because these new ones, this one's about a year old, no longer made in the US, unfortunately. Very sad. I think these ones are made in China, and the quality, yeah, say no more. This one's been repaired by Knight CB because it failed within a year. So, unfortunately, the legendary K40 is no longer legendary for its build quality. Okay, here we are in the shed. What I'm going to do, I'm going to set up that old original Uniden 200 and let's see if there's anyone around that we can test it out with. So bear with me while I connect it all up. Incidentally, in case you're wondering, that's not a CB. That's a HF transceiver for amateur radio. I'm currently studying my amateur license and looking to get into that. That is in a completely different class altogether. I could hear someone then. So we'll have a look at that another day, but for now we'll stick to a basic old 40 channel CB, I think. Okay, so there's the old girl connected up. I'm just going to flick the antenna switch over because it's plugged into another radio at the moment. There we go. So immediately you can see a bit of activity on the meter. So we're on the channel 19, which is where everyone used to congregate and shout, but I'll just have a quick rotate and let's just see. This is standard FM 40 channels in the UK. Turn my preamp off because I'm dragging in a bit of noise there. And as you can see, 40 channels of absolutely nothing. Little bit of noise there. Back in the 70s and 80s, well, back in the late 70s, 80s, I should say, you weren't going to find a spare channel out there. So let's give it a shout and let's just see if there's anybody out there that's not talking and just listening in. 19194, Roger.
Roger, Breaker.
Yeah, cheers, Breaker. Could you give me a radio check, please? Got an old Uniden 200 I've just got fixed up here.
Yeah,
oh, lovely. Yeah, cheers for that. You got a Redditch this way, yeah? Yeah, I got you. It's got a lazy meter, this one has. It's between 7 and a 9, but I can hear you. You're nice and clear.
Yeah, Roger, yeah. Well, you're working nice and a nice old rig there. One of those old Uniden 200.
I know, it's a beautiful old thing. It's hardly a mark on it, actually. It's one I got earlier in the summer, which was in a bit of a bad state, but I've got it working, glad to say. It's a lovely old rig. It is classic, isn't it? Everything's silver. It's such classic early 80s, and its build quality is nice on it as well. Lovely. Cheers for that, mate. Have a good evening there. Yeah, you take care now. So there you go. People still talk on the CB, believe it or not. Yeah. Oh, hang on. He's still talking, isn't he? Is he still talking? Another conversation going on there. There you go, CB radio. Pretty dead now, to be honest with you. We'll have a look at sideband another day, and that will mean probably powering up the Lincoln or having a look at what this thing can do. Completely different league altogether. And yeah, we'll have a look at that later. I hope you enjoyed that. A bit of a departure from what we normally look at here. But I know quite a few of you are interested in this sort of thing. On our Facebook channel, a few people said, take a look at CB, it'd be really, really good. So hope you enjoyed that. Christmas soon. You guys take care, stay safe, look after yourselves, and we'll catch you again soon in the shed. Take care. Bye-bye.